The Doomsday Book lists a manor in Silly Town, which is now known as Westdean in Singleton near Chichester on the South Downs. Even today, the estate round the big house flourishes, and stepping into its gardens and parks takes you back to a different age. In Edwardian times, the 8,500-acre estate, with its village, church, farms and woodlands, was bought by the immensely wealthy William and Evelyn James. William was an explorer and hunter. Mrs. Evelyn James is described in an Edwardian society magazine called The Onlooker as a popular and clever hostess, well known in royal circles, whom the king delighteth to honour. Certainly Edward VII was a frequent guest at her lavish shooting parties and amateur theatricals. According to the magazine article, the secret of Mrs. James's success with her guests was as follows. She is a model hostess, for she keeps the domestic machinery always firmly out of sight. Rumour had it that Mrs. James was the king's mistress. Her son Edward claimed that she was, in fact, the king's daughter. The staff remained silent on the matter. Edward James is now dead, but many of his staff, including John Howick and Rose Thompson, are still working at Westdean today.
The lead's getting loose, John. The electric lead.
Rose started as a chambermaid. Now she is the chief housekeeper in charge of seven staff. John Howick was born in the village.
I came here 1947, which is 40 years ago. We got all the chimneys swept and the house cleaned, and then we were all in readiness for Mr. James to come home. We had to keep the house, absolutely in readiness so that a couple of days we could get everything organised for him. And we should start one end of the house, clean through, and by the time we'd got through, we had to turn around and go back again. If your face didn't fit with Mr. James, I mean to say, you really... Well, everybody said, well, you're out. And I think that was perfectly true. When Mr. James was here, he wasn't an easy man to look after, really, because he was so... Well, with hygiene and that, you had to be so careful. Everything had to be just spot on.
Yes, that's right.
But, I don't think he was really that bad.
Are you getting fixed?
Just about.
There's one occasion I can remember. It was I was making the bed with the housekeeper, and she took the pillows and put them on the table by the bed. And he happened to come into the room at that particular moment, and he said, I want those pillowcases changed. The tray has been on that table and there could be germs. So we had to change the pillowcases and put them fresh ones on. There was no way that we would get away with it. You always had to make sure that you, all his linen that you carried it in a clean sheet.
I haven't got my glasses on.
Oh, you want the inscription? That's right, sort of, shall we? It says, presented to Edward Frank Willis James by the inhabitants of Westdean and District, October the 10th, 1907. I believe that was when they arrived home by special train, and it was presented at Singleton Station.
That's it, when
they
had the station.
That's right, yes. Then yeah. After that, I think they were taken home to Westdean House here in a carriage pulled by the state workmen.
Oh, That's it, and then the evening they had fireworks and everything.
That's right, and all the. That's right, the drive was all lit by smaller oil lamps, like fairy lamps in those days.
Mm.
And I believe a newspaper cutting said that the wind, it was rather windy that day, so of course a lot of the lights got blown out, unfortunately.
The shooting trophies, well, unless they go back up on the wall, I gather they will go back in store again, which is a pity, really, because once they were all round the marble hall walls, and it was rather nice, you know.
This is a big brute.
It certainly is.
They did shoot so many of them, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
Such a shame. One of Edward's uncles was out shooting, and he shot an elephant. And I suppose he was wanting his photograph taken on top of it, and could have only stunned it because the elephant got up with his one leg and killed him. I mean, if that story is true, I don't know, but that is how it goes. Yeah. Personally, I don't hold with it, but that was their sport in those days, wasn't it?
Edward fell desperately in love with a beautiful Viennese ballet dancer, Tilly Losch. Their marriage was a much publicized disaster. In spite of his spending vast amounts of money on her, Tilly constantly rejected him. It ended in a bitter divorce. Rose remembers the shock it caused in the village.
I was living in the village then, but it did make a big scandal, and it hit all the papers, I mean, say, both here and abroad. And it was a bit nasty at times, I think, but it was one of those things, you know, that it was not covered up very well.
Unexpectedly, in the prime of life, Edward James announced that he had decided to give away his whole estate. The house, its rich contents, the village, some 140 houses and cottages, 11 farms and 100 outbuildings in 6,000 acres of land. He wanted to see a revival of dying arts and crafts, and today his dream is taking shape. Students now live and work where his parents once entertained royalty. Staff and estate workers are now answerable to the trustees of the Edward James Foundation and the college. Changes on the estate are taken quietly in their stride, but in many ways life goes on much as before. John Mills has been the farm manager at West Dean for many years and helps Mick Mann, who's one of the younger keepers on the estate.
The shooting today is not on the great big lavish parties it was in those days. It's more of a social kind of thing, and whereby in those days probably they shot anywhere up to 1,000 pheasants on an average sort of day. Today if one gets 100 or thereabouts, one's quite happy and a great deal of pleasure and fun is added on.
There's a nice spot there, John, look.
Oh yes, Nick. Yeah. Very good nest.
Yeah, there is in there. Surprising old rooks haven't found that one.
Eggs are...
Yeah, they're nuisance.
collected daily from the laying pens. If they didn't do that, you see, the pheasant would lay about 10 eggs and then probably sit on, whereas by where he's collecting them daily, it could lay 100, 120 eggs probably. And then from there, they are transferred to the incubator, which acts as a foster mother, if you like. Mr. James's father was a great shooting man, but the late Mr. James, in my opinion, never did like.
You're quite pleased with that, aren't
you? Mr. James actually was part of the shooting, and he brought out his wife, who was Tilly Lott, as you know probably, where she was sitting on the shooting stick, and she looked so beautiful and lovely that he was looking at her all the time, and Partridge came over, which he supposedly shot at and missed, and shot a white hat or something or another, and that was a bad omen, do you reckon? His marriage very sadly ended in divorce, and I think he was pretty upset about that at the time. He probably never got over it. The estate is very similar today to what it was, well, 50 years or more ago, probably. The labour is no longer required on a lot of things. Mechanisation has taken over. And so we have this very rush, tear sort of attitude today of where we used to work in gangs and thoroughly enjoy ourselves. That is one of the biggest letdowns. I'm not so sure we're any better off, actually. When I had been out with Mr. James, or he'd been around the farms with me, which he used to do now and again, the thing that sticks in my mind, going back to 1966, when after we'd gone all the way around with various experts and one thing or another, he said, came to me at the end of the exercise, put his hand on my shoulder, and he said, "John," he said, "I realise you have to use some artificial manures. You'll have to use some sprays. But do look after the soil." And I thought that was excellent advice.
Coke Mitchell, like his father before him, has worked on the estate all his life.
Well, I don't do a lot with the sheep now. The shepherd comes and asks me to give him a hand, I'll go out and give him a hand. Otherwise, I go over to Mr. Hyman's, do a bit of gardening.
Haven't done much?
I'd sooner be walking behind the horses and the ploughs like I was before, when I first started work. It was very enjoyable then. You could talk to the animals, and the more you talk to an animal, the more it'll do for you. And I learnt that off of my father. And ever since that, I even talk to any animal. And you'll always tame it down. If it's a bit bored, it'll always tame down if you keep talking to it. I was born in this house, and my mother was born here, first I know of, and she courted my father from here, and he lived down on Crowthall Farm. I've lived here all my life. Just over 74 years. Wouldn't give it up for nothing. Really wonderful life.
Arthur Hintz worked as a gardener at West Dean in the days when they were expected to provide all the produce for the big house.
Oh, yes, it was a hard life, but
happy life, really, I think, really. Well, we started at 7 o'clock in the morning and had an hour for dinner and then knocked off at 5 at night. There were about 30 gardeners there just before the war. Five of us lived together up in the bothy there, boarded together. And, you know, had a lady to do for us, look after us. About 7 or 8, I think, there are nowadays. It's all watering can days in them days, before the war, the old days. Now it's all old spike work.
Today, Arthur is especially well known for the fig tree, which he alone has lovingly tended throughout his life.
Well, I've been looking after the fig tree for 30 years, winter and summer, you know. You've got to, in the winter, take it all down and tie it back up again. Then thin it all out and pick your fruits in the summer line. It has two crops of fruit, one on the old wood and one on the new wood.
Vera Smith has lived in West Dean all her life, as her father and grandfather did before her. She's the church organist and gives piano lessons to village children.
Grandfather was here for over 50 years, and he did all the gold leaf. He was head decorator, and he used to visit Mrs. James every morning. He had to, in her bedroom, to get his orders, which he did not like doing at all. He did find her a bit difficult. Oh, he was ever so nice. He was a wonderful squire, he was. He did a lot of good. But she was very good, but she was a different type of, you know, lady, a bit flighty and, you know, but anyway, they did a lot of good. And right, they gave the children, the school children, a lovely Christmas tea and entertainment every year. And she distributed warm clothing to the parents and a pair of boots to every child. They built the village school, and Mr. James gave the organ to the church.
Vera's view of Edward James, their son, and Tilly, his wife, was a little different.
Sit. He was quite a different character, quite a different style, yes. I didn't come in contact with him very much, but I do actually remember him reading the lessons in church on a Sunday evening before he met Tilly Losh. Well, we never really saw very much of them till he brought her here, and we all had a big party. You know, the whole village was invited, and they were going to do wonderful things. Oh, what they were going to do to the village, you know. And of course, it faded out because she was taken ill that night, and the church bells didn't ring the next morning because of her illness, and that was the end of what we heard.
Ivan Hicks, the garden manager, became Edward's confidant in later years and also shared his views on gardening.
The marriage finally broke up, followed by a scandalous divorce case. Then he travelled off to Mexico looking for his earthly paradise. He found it in a remote corner of Mexico, where he proceeded to build a series of fantastic surrealistic follies, and where he continued to write poetry, largely about Tilly Losh. I like the magic and power that gardens have, despite what you put into them. They seem to do it themselves somehow, particularly if you encourage self-seeding of foxgloves and silver thistles and forget-me-nots and things like that. You add to it, but the garden has a creation of its own. Edward James had similar thoughts about a garden. He loved the rare and exotic, but he also loved the humble dog rose and wildflowers particularly. Well, I've been involved since I've been here in restoring West Dean Gardens, which are extremely interesting and very old garden. And so I see plenty of work in the years ahead for me, continuing the replanting, particularly with the cedars, which have been here for hundreds of years, and there's a gap in replanting. So it's a wonderful opportunity to plant many of the different trees which I like and Edward liked as well. Edward James' main function in life seemed to be a patron of the arts, and so to give it all away at the end of his life seemed a natural thing to do. After all, he often said to me, it's easier for a camel to get through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to get into the kingdom of heaven. Edward James wrote to me frequently from all parts of the world. In fact, I've got hundreds of his letters. And he wrote in the most extraordinary style, using multicoloured felt-tip pens and sticking stamps and photographs here and there. And I reciprocated in my fashion by decorating envelopes and sending them back to him. He framed them and was collecting them, which was rather flattering. So now I'm framing some of his and hanging them on the wall.
Edward died in 1984 and was buried amongst his favourite trees in the Arboretum. He wanted to be remembered only as a poet. One of his last poems, probably written to Tilly, is about paradise.
To be in paradise with growing things, being with trees, I'd hanker less for wings. Though golden birds gathered in spiral flight shine there more splendid than the stars at night. To be in paradise, to be with you, I'd be the springing grass, you'd be the dew.
Edward James was not always an easy master. His staff had to work extraordinarily hard for him, but today they seem to have few regrets.
I think I'm most fortunate, actually, to be living on and taking part in one of the best estates in the country, I think. No question of doubt about it.
Most of what he dreamt about is actually happening. The estate is working as a whole. The arts and crafts are being taught here in a very responsible way.
I prefer Esther with the college and that, yes.
It's a really wonderful life, working on the farm. I don't think you could beat it.